Good morning. We will now prepare for worship with this video.
Let us build a house where love can dwell and all can safely live. A place where saints and children tell how hearts learn to forgive. Built of hopes and dreams and visions, rock of faith and vault of grace. Here the love of Christ shall end divisions. All are welcome, all are welcome, all are welcome in this place.
Let us build a house where prophets speak and words are strong. Symbol of God's grace, there is one.
Indeed, all are welcome. Good morning. What a great breakfast we had yesterday, and thanks to the workers and those who attended. And I think some of us, me included, were surprised that our little airport is such a hub of activity. I think we're even thinking maybe a tour down the road. Our May breakfast, which will be May the 4th, will be the kickoff to our hymn party fundraiser. And Frances, our music director, she's going to play one verse of all 833 hymns in our hymn book. And you and your family and friends can pledge money per hymn or per half hour. And the pledge sheets are available for you to pick up and take home and get your friends and families to sign up for a hymn or a time. And I will put these in the coffee room or at the back. And more information will be shared about this event. It's going to be a fun day, and hopefully you'll be able to stop by for a short time, or maybe even for a long time. And remember, if you play an instrument, bring it along and join the party. Sounds like a fun day. And that leads to another event, our Repair Cafe, being held on April 20th. And there are sign-up sheets in the coffee room and the front hall if you can donate goods. And I see that Candace Goodchild is here this morning, and she'll be able to answer any questions you might have. And I know she has been working very hard to make this event successful. And one last announcement. The first meeting of the revamped Pastoral Care Committee will be held on Wednesday, April 24th at 1 p.m. This meeting is open to new members who would like to be part of this important ministry, caring for our congregation and our community. And this morning, we welcome the Reverend Jane Swatridge to Knox. Reverend Jane and Reverend Heather are swapping pulpits today. Reverend Jane serves as interim minister for Knox, Port Carling, and Zion Torrance, and Reverend Heather now serves as their interim moderator. We know God's Spirit will be with Jane and Heather this morning as they share God's word. Welcome, Jane.
Good morning. How are you? Because you look pretty good from here. And for anyone watching this later at home, you should be aware that the cameras go both ways. I can see you. Do you stand for the call to worship? I honestly don't know. I'm used to asking everyone to stand for the call to worship. Shall we do that? As you feel comfortable. Praise God, praise Him in this sanctuary. The earth, praise God for deeds of goodness and love. Praise God with every instrument and gift that He provides. Everything that breathes, give praise to the Lord. Please be seated. Let's join together. Our hearts and our spirits, let's come together in prayer. Let us pray. We come to praise You, our Heavenly Parent, the source of all we could want and wise to know what we truly need. Today we offer our voices and prayers, our thanks and our undistracted presence, the songs in our heart as well as the struggles in our soul. Accept all that we bring and open us up to Your inspiring, unifying, healing Spirit. Wise and patient God, lead us away from all that tempts us to be less than the people You created us to be. Help us to move past stubborn grudges and thorny regrets, our little jealousies and big egos, so we don't miss the wondrous blessings with family and friends, the blessings of simple pleasures and meaningful pursuits. Unburden us by Your gracious attention to our silent admissions. Redeeming Lord, may we be Easter people, renewed every day by the certainty of Your forgiving love. We rely on the promise of reconciliation through our Lord Jesus, who taught us the words we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be Thy name. Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For Thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Be kind to one another, wrote Paul to the early church at Ephesus. Tender-hearted, forgiving one another as God in Christ has forgiven you. And therefore be imitators of God as beloved children, and live in love as Christ loved us and gave Himself up for us, a fragrant offering and a sacrifice to God. May we see one another as God sees us, valued and lovable, because we are held in His grace and we are forgiven all things. May that truth fill us with the peace of heaven. This isn't in the bulletin, but you're just going to have to get used to this. Take a moment, just a brief moment. Turn to the people just beside you, in front or behind, and bless them. Look them in the eye and bless them with the peace of Jesus Christ. Thank you. Let's stand and sing together. Morning Has Broken. You'll find it at 8:14 if you prefer the hymn book. How is everyone? Doing okay? Did you have a pretty good week? Yes? Okay. Good. Good, good. I wonder if you could help me with something. I'm new here. This is my very first time here. I've never been here before. So I don't really know everybody. So when you go someplace for the first time, you very often bring sort of a hostess gift. Right? And everyone has been so kind in welcoming me. I want to give a little something back. So, I'm wondering if you can help me give this out. Is that okay? Do you mind going for a little walk and giving a few things out? Okay. How's that look? Okay, well, I'm going to take that as a good thing. So, here, I'm going to give you each, you know, like two or three or four, and just go give them out. Just, oh no, there's plenty left for you later, don't you worry. I don't want you to worry, there's lots left for you later. So, do you want to go and give some out? Okay, here, there's a whole bunch there. All over the place.
Nice.
Okay, do you want to just give, try giving like one per person?
I know.
Okay, good, go for it. Go for it. That would really help me out. Because like I say, I'm new.
That would be a bad thing. Policy.
why? Why in goodness' name would a total stranger show up with gifts? Quick question first. Did you get anything back when you gave somebody a cookie? Did you get anything back? Anybody slip you a loony? No. No, I didn't think so. What did you get back in return? At least that emphatic, right? At least that excited. Thank you. Right? Yeah. Yes. Because you did something nice. And I appreciated that you took it everywhere and made sure everybody got one. You were very careful and thorough. And I appreciate that. But that's kind of why we do it. Can you think of a reason why we do stuff? For no reason whatsoever. Can you think of it?
To be nice.
To be nice. Exactly. To be nice. Is there anything wrong with being nice? Is there anything difficult about being nice? I mean, how hard is it? That took you, what, 3 minutes? How hard is it? Exactly. How hard is it? We do it. We do it because God asks us to. It's actually that simple. It's just that simple. He asks us to. Not because we're going to get anything back. Not because we have any expectations. No one's going to pay us. Just because He asks us to. You got a lovely thank you. Did you get smiles? Anybody get a hug? Anybody get a hug? Really? Really? Who wants a hug? Here, bring it in. Thank you for doing that. But that's why we do it. Because this is what makes the world go round. You do something nice for somebody and they say thank you. And somebody does something lovely for you. And what do you do?
Thanks.
Absolutely.
Or
hug. Big hug. Or a smile or something lovely so that they know they're appreciated. That's how the world goes round. We share kindness. That's all there is to it. And that's actually what keeps God smiling. Want to make him happy? Want to make God happy? Do something kind for absolutely no reason. It's all you got to do. Let's sing. I'm going to live so God can use me.
Thank you.
As we prepare to hear the word, I believe there is a video prepared for us to watch.
The Old Testament lesson this morning is from Psalm 112, verses 1 through 9. Praise the Lord. Happy are those who fear the Lord, who greatly delight in his commandments. Their descendants will be mighty in the land. The generation of the upright will be blessed. Wealth and riches are in their houses, and their righteousness endures forever. They rise in the darkness as a light for the upright. They are gracious, merciful, and righteous. It is well with those who deal generously and lend, whose conduct their affairs with justice. For the righteous will never be moved. They will be remembered forever. They are not afraid of evil tidings. Their hearts are firm, secure in the Lord. Their hearts are steady. They will not be afraid. In the end, they will look in triumph on their foes. They have distributed freely. They have given to the poor. Their righteousness endures forever. And the Gospel according to Matthew, chapter 5, verses 13 through 20. You are the salt of the earth. But if salt has lost its taste, how can its saltiness be restored? It is no longer good for anything, but is thrown out and trampled underfoot. You are the light of the world. A city built on a hill cannot be hid. No one, after lighting a lamp, puts it under the bushel basket, but on the lamp stand, and it gives light to all in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father in heaven. Do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have not come to abolish, but to fulfill. For truly I tell you, until heaven and earth pass away, not one letter, not one stroke of a letter will pass from the law until all is accomplished. Therefore, whoever breaks one of the least of these commandments and teaches others to do the same will be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever does them and teaches them will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I tell you, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church.
Many years ago, I was walking through the halls of my high school, Thistletown Collegiate, northwest corner of Toronto. It was week one of being a niner in a 1,600-person high school. I'm walking through the hall, a teacher, completely unknown to me, is standing in the hall, just watching as the students are changing classes. And he calls out to me, "Hey, Swatridge!" I turn to this stranger, shocked, not a little alarmed, but I ignore the big, round, grinning face, and I keep walking to my class. I tell this story to my mom and dad at dinner that evening. Dad considers this for a while and then remembers that he heard about an old student of his that is now teaching at some school in Etobicoke, was all he knew. The teacher that had called out to me was Ian Wright. He had been a troublemaking brat in my dad's grade 10 geography class at Weston Collegiate. Ian dropped geography after grade 10 and then picked it up at university becoming a geography teacher and then a department head, just like my dad. Mr. Wright must have seen the name Swatridge among the Niners coming into the school that year. He was apparently watching for me. It must have been pretty obvious. He saw my father in me. This kid he'd never seen before in his life, walking past him in a crowd, and he knew that kid's a Swatridge. What parts of your parents do you carry? In your face, your gestures, your voice, perhaps your character. Hopefully, we carry the best parts of our parents, and likewise, may our children carry the best parts of us. Now, what about our divine parent? Do people see our Heavenly Father in us? Our Lord Jesus knows exactly who we are within God's earthly creation, and he tells us during his Sermon on the Mount, "You are the salt of the earth. You are the light of the world." His sermon includes some of the most inspiring and affirming words in Scripture. This passage is also one of the most challenging. Because isn't Jesus supposed to be the light of the world? According to John's Gospel, Paul's letters, John's first letter, according to the ancient Psalms, God is the source of light, his Son is the light of the world. Now let's be clear. When Jesus calls us the light of the world, we didn't just get a big promotion. We need to look at this passage. It's not entirely uncommon to hear someone described as being the salt of the earth. Let's start there. We're referring to someone's beautifully kind and selfless deed, or perhaps a character trait that motivates them routinely to acts of generosity. These folks are viewed as essentially good, and they may be held up as an example to others. However, for the folks in the crowd that day, listening to Jesus, salt was not a personal descriptor of someone. It had nothing to do with exemplary morals or deeds. It carried no conceptual meaning at all. For these folks, salt was as good as its function. Consider that box of sifto in the cupboard. Common to many kitchens, cheap, unexceptional. When it's not doing what it is intended to do, we don't think about it. It's pretty well just taking up space. However, out of the cupboard, fulfilling its intended purpose, nothing else can do all that salt can do. Nothing else can enhance and preserve and add zest in quite the same way. How then are we to function as salty Christians? This passage comes early in the Sermon on the Mount, which begins with, as we know, the Beatitudes. They conclude with this blessing. Blessed are you when people revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Immediately after that verse, he presents the metaphors of salt and light. Yes, he's saying, openly committed Christians will face trials. We'll face challenges to our integrity because we insist on transparency. We'll be bad-mouthed and lies may be told to discredit us because we speak the truths that others perhaps would prefer to hide. But Jesus says, shine in that darkness, stay salty, continue to preserve, to protect, to perpetuate the word that feeds us. He's asking us to be stronger than the cynics and the critics. He's affirming our hope in him so that we can rise above and even reverse the vortex of negativity and judgment that threatens to drag people downward. Christians should be easy to spot outside of our church walls. We're meant to be spicing up lives all around us with joyful energy, fearless confidence for living, sharing all of our gifts generously, known for our honest character, I hope, attending to needs with love and kindness without judgment or agenda or any expectation. Jesus preaches a very challenging sermon indeed. But this is how we salt the earth and preserve the word, by keeping it fresh and alive through our own living. This is how people know who we are as followers of Christ. And yes, we are getting to that second metaphor, but quickly I want to clarify a detail in Jesus' sermon about that pronoun, you. In English, it's ambiguous. It could be singular, it could be plural. However, the original Greek is very clear. You is you. It's all of us. It's every single one of us together. Jesus is addressing the entire community of faith before they're even an established group. He's already priming these folks to think and to act as one body, because that's his hope for us. But it's also his pastoral wisdom. Jesus understands from the very beginning of his ministry that his followers will need one another. We'll need each other for mutual encouragement and support, for accountability and correction, for truly effective ministry in his name. Even by the manner of his speech, he's casting a vision for his future church. And of course he's right. We know that one of us cannot hold back all the darkness in the world. One of us cannot rid the world of injustice or abuse or the bullying that happens in every age group, or poverty or hunger, or hateful gunmen who believe that violence solves their problems. But darkness must obey the power of light. Our combined candle power is awesome. There's a large church in the midst of the slums of Chicago. It's actually identified as having the poorest zip code in the entire US of A. There are just over 150 members on the roll, but they can barely afford one staff person, their minister. Every position in the church, every task and responsibility is taken up by volunteers. A few years ago, they started hosting campouts, urban campouts. 60 or 70 folks, mostly men, would take their barbecues and their lawn chairs, their sleeping bags, their guitars, hot dogs and s'mores, and they would set up for the night in front of an inner city crack house. It's a very simple tactic, no violence, no confrontation. Just several dozen folks singing around a campfire all night, many nights in a row. The customers to this particular house would find it inconvenient. Business would dry up, and the proprietor of such an establishment would soon be closed. The perpetual campfire approach has successfully shuttered at least 15 such houses in the middle of Chicago, and they intend to keep at it. Jesus names us to be salt and light if we are to be his disciples. So that prompts some honest questions. Are those good and appropriate descriptions for Knox? Now, did your thoughts just cry out, "Yes, of course that's us"? Or did you wonder if there are other ways, more ways, for Christ's church to burn brighter? We know what it means for us to belong to God, to identify ourselves as God's children, to be the family of our brother Christ. How do others identify us? What are the descriptive words used for us, used for Knox, by folks who've never been to this church? How does our faith impact other people? Do folks know that there's this lovely, warm embrace awaiting them at this church? Do folks know that they can come into this sanctuary and experience hope in the midst of their personal darkness? There is no way that it's just a coincidence that Knox sits just minutes from a highway on a major arterial road. You're that lamp on a stand. You're that city on a hill. Jesus' sermon is for each of us as much as it is for all of us. Salt of the earth, light of the world, not salt of my kitchen and light of my porch. This is about getting out there. This is about merging passionate faith with God-given gifts to push back against the darkness. This is about adding salt to the politically correct attempts to water down Christ's good news of truth and redemption that is for all people. Jesus states, oh, so matter-of-factly, that his followers, those who work for his sake, in his name, to his glory, are salt with a lively, ever-fresh faith that cannot be ignored. The one we trust, the one we love, says we are light, together lifting high a torch that points folks to God. How shall we do it? How shall we continue to do it? Think about it, pray about it, talk about it. Heather may give you a test when she gets back. How has God already affirmed the ministries of Knox Church? Where is God leading his church next in the afterglow of Lent's renewal and Easter's new life? Jesus knows who we are. With him as our partner, there's no limit to what we can do as his church. There is no limit. Amen. And thanks be to God. Let's stand and sing together. Brother, sister, let me serve you. You'll find it at 635 if you prefer the hymn book. Just the first three verses. As we come to prayer, are there people, situations that you would like to bring up for the congregation to hold in their personal prayers this week? Is there anyone who would like to request prayer? Yes. I hope everyone heard that. Please hold the name Alicia in your prayers this week. Is there anyone else who'd like us to keep prayers in our hearts and in our words and in our minds this week? I hope everyone could hear that. Hold the name Mary in your thoughts and prayers this week, please. Did I see a hand at the back? Absolutely. The parents of the Humboldt Broncos, if you weren't able to hear that, and if I may, with your approval, add the entire community that still must be rocked. Are there others? I don't want to miss a hand. Let's join in prayer, everyone. Let's join our hearts. God of all, Redeemer of each, we offer gratitude and wondrous awe for your boundless love, for the genius of creation's design, and for your unwavering faithfulness to humankind. Teach and encourage us to respond with consistent kindness, with inclusive, unconditional acts of compassion and generosity that point to your greatness. Ever wise God, thank you for the gospel reminder that you are constant, even as our faith may ebb and flow. Thank you for receiving our doubt and our questions with grace and understanding. Help us to embrace the mysteries of the divine and to trust that you are never distant, but here, now, as close as this breath. Our ever-present strength and peace for the living of these days. Savior, for eternity, save us daily from the threat of discouragement at the state of the world and humanity's response. Help us to widen our view so in the midst of wars and fear, revenge seekers and online haters we may also recognize signs of hope in the response of global and local communities, in the images we see of strangers tending to wounded strangers, and in the genuine commitment of leaders acting to protect the innocent and end strife. Lift us up, Lord, with the assurance that even our smallest gesture, the simplest change in our habits and lifestyle, can positively impact and bless others. Open our hearts to allow your persuasive spirit to inform and transform our routine patterns and endeavors. God, the very home of tenderness and strength, attend to our personal prayers as we offer the names and the situations that fill our thoughts today. We rely on your goodness, that in your time and in ways unknown to us, you will bring courage, relief, and peace into the lives of your children and the life of your creation. It is in Jesus' name that we pray all things. Amen. Let's stand again and complete the hymn we started, verses 4, 5, and 6 of Brother, Sister, Let Me Serve You. Now let us go in his peace, encouraged to be as salty as we dare and to hold up his light, the light that first shone into our own lives and is meant to be taken forth. May the grace of God, the redeeming mercy of Jesus Christ, and the sustaining fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with each and every one of us and all whom we love, this day and always, and together all the people said, Amen.